interview on the 21st of March 2016 for the project Our Roots, Our Journey, Our City. Right, so first of all, can I ask you your name?
Yes, I'm Carole Elliot. I'm a health visitor. I was the Bangladeshi community's dedicated health visitor for about 12 years. So I got to know all the families very, very well.
Can I ask you about first coming into contact with the Bangladeshi community in Sunderland?
Well, as a health visitor in Hendon, I did have a few of the families on my caseload. And after some research by Andrew Field, which looked into the difficulties that the community had, the health authority decided at that time that we'd have a dedicated Bangladeshi project. And I asked if I could be that dedicated health visitor. And I worked with two people from the community, Raju and Rahina Chowdhury.
And when did you first come into contact with the community?
In 1990, but that's when the project started, but I was visiting some of them 2 years before that, so it would be 1988.
Was it easy to interact with the community when you first came into contact with them?
It was much easier when we started the project and had two Bengali speakers, because communication was, you know, a massive difficulty for them, particularly the women.
Was language difficult?
Yes, and at that time I don't think there was any interpreting services, so it was wonderful for them to have these two people with me that, you know, would help, you know, solve whatever they wanted to know. And for them, that was a big thing, from having nobody that they were able to communicate with, and suddenly, you know, to have their own people. And myself, who had actually been to Bangladesh, and I think that they did appreciate that fact that I knew a lot about, you know, their life there. So they were very, very accepting of me and very friendly.
How long do you think it took to develop that trust?
I think it was, I would say, about 2 years. Yes, 2 years.
And then what did you do as a health visitor working with the Bangladeshi community?
Well, we did a lot of surveys asking what people wanted. You know, how they saw the health service. I discovered actually that none of the preschool children were going to nursery. And then I soon realised it was because mums and dads didn't know what they would be giving the children up to. And I suppose it's always bad for any parent not knowing where you're sending your children. So I took quite a lot of groups of women round, and they really loved the nursery. And, you know, we got all the children into nursery, so that was brilliant. And then we had our own baby clinic at the old Hendon Health Centre. It was very well attended, from hardly any of the parents going to the other clinics where there wasn't an interpreter. It was very well attended, and they enjoyed coming. It was a social thing for them as well, I think. We used to have a good old gossip, and it was really, really nice. I always used to look forward to the clinics. I was a bit concerned also that there was no smoke alarms, and I worked with the fire service who provided them. And I saw a lot of lovely old men that used to be sitting, granddads, in the houses, and I thought, you know, that they should be nice for them to have something. So I worked with Age Concern, and we did set up an elderly group. It was health orientated. I used to get speakers in to talk about different aspects, and that went very well. And we did a lot of work also around pan chewing. because that's quite a dangerous thing. Mm-hmm. And I think in Bangladesh, people chewed pan because they were hungry. And it staved off the hunger pans. But of course, that wasn't the case here. But it was habit. Mm-hmm. And also, they smoked as well. So, you know, we had all the community checked out for that. So that was a really good project. Also, they used to say to me, we have no prayer room at the hospital, nowhere they could go and pray when they were either visiting their relatives or they were in hospital. So again, I linked with the chaplain and they got a prayer room, which they were really very pleased about because, as you know, they pray five times a day. And I'm very pleased that they're getting the new mosque now, because, you know, that's a recent, and it does look like a mosque, and it's going to be beautiful when it actually finishes. We did lots of health education and childcare around the children. And the other thing is that I linked with social services, because when you come to a new country, you don't always know the rules and what you can and can't do, you know. That was very good. We had a social worker come in and groups around the house, the houses, just to talk about the law and everything like that.
What was your perception of the quality of life of the Bangladeshi community?
Well, initially, when they came, they thought, you know, it was going to be a better life. And yes, it has probably turned out that way. But having been to these wonderful, peaceful villages, but there again, it's the stress of, can you eat? And that's a massive stress. But it was so peaceful and lovely that sometimes I think that there was a big piece missing from the quality of their lives, and it lay in Bangladesh.
What do you think the relationship was between the Bangladeshi community and the wider population of Sunderland?
Very isolated. I don't really think there was, you know, much of a relationship, if I'm honest. But it certainly seems to have changed now. I mean, I haven't worked with the community for about 8 years, so I'm not au fait with what's happening at the moment. But they were very, very isolated, really. Very much so.
Did you have an opinion on why the isolation existed?
I think it's because they were the first group of people to come from another country, a big group of people, into Sunderland, and I think people just didn't know very much about them, or and they just lived alongside them without really communicating mm-hmm. with them, which was sad.
Do you think there was hostility there?
Oh, yes. There was hostility. I think it's much improved now. I mean, it's what you get with any population that's different, or people don't take the time to understand and know that they're just the same as us, trying to do the best thing for their families, and that's what they were trying to do.
Did you ever witness examples of racism or discrimination?
I did, mm-hmm. yes. But I was always able to deal with it.
Yeah. Yeah. And then you went to Bangladesh yourself?
I did.
Yeah.
I wanted to go to Sylhet.
Right.
And it's a very vibrant place, but no systems, you know, even India has its roads, its railways. Bangladesh is just chaotic, but it's wonderful because of that. and you never see people complaining or groaning. They've got the lot and they get on with it, and the children are happy and they're always smiling. And it's a marvellous experience. really was. And I've been going there for, I've been there about 12 times now, because I started a mother and baby clinic there. The women used to tell me tales of how hard it was for women, especially, and, you know, the lack of health care. And so I was awarded a sort of a scholarship from the Royal College of Nursing. And I used that money to go and set up a mother and baby clinic in an area where there was no health care at all. And it's fantastic. I raised the money. We have a purpose-built clinic. Put in toilets and a deep bore well, and got into solar cooking because it's free. And Bangladesh is becoming very deforested with everybody just taking the wood for fires and for cooking. So it's the first solar ovens that they'd ever seen, you know, first ever in Bangladesh. I tried to start a fishery, but that really didn't work because people were hungry and they just ate the fish, to be honest. But that was all right. I set up a women's sewing cooperative, and they get training to use the machine from a tailor. And when they've passed after a 6 months course, we give them the machine and they can then provide income for the family. Got uniforms for the school and started a scouts group there. That was amazing to see them all in the little uniforms. We supported some of the more able children who couldn't afford to go on any further, you know, from basic schools, because they had no books and things, they just wrote on slates. And to bring some expertise back into the village. We had soap making, because I thought, you can't give people toilets and not give them soap. And they couldn't afford to buy any in this particular village. So we started to show them how to make their own. It didn't look very nice, but it did the trick. There's no nice perfume like, you know, it is here. But it was great fun. Everything I did in Bangladesh was great fun, and it brought a lot of joy to the people. The life expectancy's gone up. You know, it was 49 for a man. And so many children dying before they got to the first birthday. I worked with the World Health Organization, who came and gave the immunization program. I've done so much, probably more in Bangladesh, because there's more need. And it's been absolutely wonderful.
Did your experiences working in Bangladesh change your relationships with Sunderland's Bangladeshi community?
It did. It definitely did, because I know you don't have to be a mother to be a health visitor. I know that. You can learn. It's training. Although people think she hasn't even got children, they'll say, to some health visitors. But I've got to say that understanding, it's a unique thing. And, you know, other people might think they understand, but, you know, to go there and see it and see the struggles and, you know, the way of life. And I can understand that when they come here, they're very protective to keep that way of life. And I know it's harder for them to do that here. In fact, it's, to my mind, it's much freer in Bangladesh. But I think the concern to keep everything in place, I think they've worked hard at that, to, you know, keep their culture, and because it's so important to them.
What do you think were the main challenges the community faced?
The weather. Because, you know, the women would come over with the beautiful sandals and their saris, and, you know, where could they go? And boots just don't look the same. So it took a while for them to realise and to get, you know, warm coats. And at the time, the language was big. It wasn't the only difficulty, but it was a big problem, because, you know, unless you had anyone in your family that spoke a bit English, you know, what could you do? Couldn't do anything. All the services were new, because health service in Bangladesh is very hit and miss and has to be paid for, as I'm sure you know. Pay a lot as well. So to come and have all these things that, because of language, at first it was difficult to access, you know. So that was a big barrier, not being able to access. And I think as a health worker, I soon realised that I couldn't just work in health. I had to link with all the other services, so every aspect was brought on, you know, at the same time, like the education and the children's services, and all the other community groups, fire service, age concern, hospital, everything. So we linked it to make it one, and it seemed to have more momentum. And I think the community at first didn't know what had happened to them. You know, everybody wanted a piece of them. They did, you know, or more surveys, you know. But they realised that it was for the benefit, and, you know, they really embraced. Mm-hmm. And for me, it's been such a positive thing.
Do you think the community has overcome a lot of the challenges that they initially faced?
Well, as I say, I haven't worked with them for about 8 years now. But definitely, I mean, now they're going to the doctors, they're going to the hospitals, they're going to their own doctors' clinics. They're accessing the nurseries, the schools. So, you know, I think, yes, that's a massive thing. From nothing to that is amazing.
And you think things are improving in Bangladesh as well?
A little. Not, you know, I've seen a little bit of improvement. I've seen more people. Everyone has a job in Bangladesh, whether it's just something on their backs, or everybody is totally busy. It's such a busy place. Everyone doing their own thing. But I think things have moved on in some areas. You know, they've got the trains now, and the roads haven't improved. They've built one or two big roads that link places, but it's absolutely terrifying. You go in the sort of rickshaw, and there's no, like, that's my side and that's your side. It's just like this, and it's really hair-raising, you know. But after a couple of times there, I got used to it, you know.
You said a bit about the quality of life in Bangladesh in comparison to some. Could you say a bit more about what you think at the moment the differences are?
Yeah. Well, the differences are they've got a health service here that looks after every single aspect of you. There's someone to refer to for every single thing. There's someone who will come and see you at home. There's nothing like that in Bangladesh. I mean, they do have hospitals, and I have been around them, and they're a bit, you know, not very well equipped. And especially when I went to they've only got one mental health hospital there. And that was quite upsetting, actually. I was upset quite a lot when I was there. But I suppose that village freedom is a wonderful thing. And I think, you know, that's missing for them. And I think they probably know that. But, you know, they've settled here now. They've brought their families over. They've opened their restaurants. They're doing quite, you know, very well. flourishing, and I think they do go back as often as they can, and they do help relatives that's still there, and so I think, you know, that's very good. This is what they've decided to do, but they still go back, so they do get a little bit of what they had before when they're able to go and relax and just enjoy it.
You talk about the freedom in the village. How do you think it's more free there than it is here?
Well, everybody knows everyone, and everybody looks after each other's children. And there's just a wonderful atmosphere in the villages, and it's very green and beautiful, actually. It really is beautiful, except in the monsoon. Where you can only see a little treetop. You get in the boat in the monsoon, you don't know where you're going because, you know, there's nothing, there's no landmarks. You don't know, you know, what's underneath you. Oh, but it was great fun, and the rain is so heavy, it actually hurts, really hurts, and everywhere's muddy, and people's houses are flooded, and they're on little tiny embankments. It's heart-rending, actually, and they get this every year. Some years worse than others. But they're never daunted, you know. I mean, our clinic roof is used for storage because it's the only double-storey thing in the village where the clinic is in Baruda. And you'd be amazed what goes on there. People's belongings and all kept on the clinic roof.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So going back to Sunderland, what do you think the Bangladeshi communities contributed to Sunderland?
I think they've contributed a lot in the catering industry, you know. And let's face it, I don't know anybody that doesn't like a good curry. I honestly don't. Yeah. Mind you, in Bangladesh, the curries these are for our palate here.
Yeah.
You know, I never had anything that resembled there, anything that resembled, you know, what people think it's, and they call it Indian food, but there's no Indian restaurants, they're all Bangladeshi. And I think they've contributed a lot to that. And I think there's a member of their community, one of the leaders, who I got great help from, you know, got to know them. And I think one of them did get the MBE. For his work in the community. So I think they're very valued, and people are accepting now, and they know a bit more about them. They're more visual now. And there's quite a lot of Bangladeshis in certain schools, and more people know about them. You know, the children want... You know, they're bilingual, and, you know, a lot of them are really quite bright. And I think they'll go on to do well. I mean, some of the girls, I understand, are going to university. Some have gone in for teaching. I think they've got a true place here. I really do.
Have you kept in touch with anyone from the community?
Yes, one or two. I'm in touch with the two people that I used to work with quite a lot. And when I see people in the town, there's one thing you never saw, you know, the women going up into town. And if I see any of them, and they always remember me, you know. And I mean, when I used to see them in their cots, they're now married, and some of them have got their own children. Same in Baruda, in the village. The people I first saw, they've now got children of their own. And that's marvellous, that. A full life circle. Brilliant.
What would your hopes for the future of the community be?
I would hope that they would get more people going to university and going into other occupations, because I think there are only so many sort of restaurants that can be sustained. And I think they realise that now. And a lot of the young people don't want to, they do want to do something different now. So that's my hope, further education.
Yeah. Is there anything that could be changed practically, do you think, to improve things?
That's a difficult one. I suppose more support given to the young people too, but they get that anyway, the same as any other children at schools. And, you know, I think it's just telling them that they can do it, that you can do anything you want. You know, just look how far they've come.